Good to gather with you today. Trust that whether you're in this room or in the Christian Education Building or watching by YouTube, you've come with your heart ready to worship the Lord and to hear from His Word today. I'm going to be starting a new series today. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about what do we believe and our values, and so we're going to switch to a more practical topic for a few weeks called What About Money? With all the things going on in our economy, with COVID-19, there's a lot of concerns. And so today we're going to see what it is that God's Word has to say, and then we'll work through some different parts of what the Bible has to say about money over the weeks to come. But to start today, I want to just read for you Psalm 24 as we focus our hearts on the Lord. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be ye lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, even lift them up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Selah. Lord, thank you that you are King of kings and Lord of lords. We are your children by your grace and mercy, and today we gather as your people to bring you worship, to be attentive to what you'd want to teach us today. Make us love you even more as we hear your word. Draw us together. And we thank you for what you'll do. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask Russ and his team to come and lead us in some songs of worship.
Come, come, Christians, join to sing. Hallelujah, amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Hallelujah. Amen. Call to worship.
Come, Christians, join to sing. Hallelujah. Amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Hallelujah. Throne reach. to God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Let's all stand for the last verse. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done.
Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord.
Made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. Oh, how marvelous. Verse 3, when with the ransomed in glory.
When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me.
How marvelous,
how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
You may be seated. Jesus. Jesus is Lord of all. He's King of kings, Lord of lords. Jesus is Lord of all. All my possessions, all my life, Jesus is Lord of all. all my tomorrows.
Time I come into your presence, I stand in awe.
How many can say amen to that? Yeah, the grace of God. Without it, where would we be? Well, today, if you have your Bible, turn with me to Luke chapter 16. I'm going to do something at each one of these lessons about money from the scriptures and share a little story. Did you know that of the 40 parables that Jesus taught, and he was the only one who taught in parables in the Bible, recorded for us, of the 40, about a third have to do with money. Of the 31,102 verses in the Bible, in the King James Version, about 2,350 talk about money and treasures and things like that. So the Bible has a lot to say about money. So why is money important? Well, first of all, we all have to deal with it, don't we? We need it for survival. It's an exchange of our life energy in services and goods in order to turn around and purchase other services and goods that we need for our lives. And so money is very important. What does the Bible teach about it? Well, we're going to learn a little bit today, but probably one of the strangest parables is this one in Luke chapter 16. And it's strange because it almost sounds like Jesus is commending something that seemed a little evil. I don't think that would be true, but let's see if we can learn what his real heart was in sharing this parable with, first of all, his disciples, and of course the Pharisees were listening in, as they so often were, and they always had a comment to make, and we'll see what they have to say at the end of it. I'm going to read it to you from the International Standard Version. It's a little bit translated into the quantities that we know today, and I'll read it. You can look on the screen. It'll be up there. And I'm going to read verses 1 to, I guess it's 15, and then we'll talk about it in a little more detail, and then we'll draw from it some principles of life on this topic of money. Why does the Bible say so much about money? What is God's part in our finances? And then what is our part? And we'll start with that this week. Next week, we'll go on to the topic of debt, and the little subtitle is Act Your Own Wage. So we'll see what we can learn from that next week. All right, let's start with the story here in Luke chapter 16. Now Jesus was saying to his disciples, a rich man had a servant manager who was accused of wasting his assets. So he called for him and asked him, what's this I hear about you? You can't be my manager any longer. Now give me a report about your management. Then the servant manager told himself, what should I do? My master is taking my position away from me. I'm not strong enough to plow, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that people will welcome me into their homes when I'm dismissed from my job. So he called for each of his master's debtors. He asked the first one, how much do you owe my master? The man replied, 100 jars of olive oil. The manager told him, get your bill, sit down quickly, and write 50. Then he asked another debtor, how much do you owe? The man replied, 100 containers of wheat. The manager told him, get your bill and write 80. The master praised the dishonest servant manager for being so clever, because worldly people are more clever than enlightened people in dealing with their own. I'm telling you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth so that when it fails, they will welcome you into eternal homes. Whoever is faithful with very little is also faithful with a lot. And whoever is dishonest with very little is also dishonest with a lot. So if you haven't been faithful with unrighteous wealth, who will trust you with true wealth? And if you haven't been faithful with what belongs to foreigners, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters, because either he will hate one and love the other, or be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and wealth. Now the Pharisees, who love money, had been listening to all this and began to ridicule Jesus. So he told them, you try to justify yourselves in front of people, but God knows your hearts. because what is highly valued by people is detestable to God. Let's just pray. Oh Lord, many of these words were yours, this parable, this story. And we pray that as we study it today, by your Holy Spirit, allow us to have understanding as to what you really intended for us to learn. That we might be wise and discerning and faithful stewards, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as is the case in the parables that Jesus told, and he explained this to his disciples, he often told parables with the intent that those who were not believers wouldn't really get it. But those who were believers would. And many times he had to go on further to explain the parable to his disciples. Bring application, bring understanding. So let's see what we can learn from this parable as we go through it. I'm going to just go through it again and a little slower and add some comments along the way because this is a fascinating story. First of all, we see here Jesus was talking to his disciples about a hypothetical situation in which a very rich man had a servant manager. And he had heard stories, slanderous stories, negative, accusing stories that this servant manager was wasting the master's wealth. So he called for him. Some things we learn from this is probably that this owner of these activities, the owner, the rich man, had probably a lot of wealth. We get that in sort of inference because he was at a distance. He had to call for his manager. The manager that was there taking care of his activities and possessions was distant from him. And he says to him, "What's this I hear about you?" And then he makes sort of, in the story, what we see in real life is kind of a fatal error. He says to him, "You can't be my manager any longer. Now give me a report about your management." Well, we know today that in our business wisdom, that if someone is failing in their duties as a manager, or as one responsible in a company, most likely the process today would be that the owner or the one in charge would call them in, kind of present to them the information, and immediately they'd be ushered out the door. There'd be no chance for them to do any further damage. It would shut down immediately. Well, in this case, as Jesus wisely did this story, he had the manager warned that he was going to be dismissed and asks him to give him a report. There's an accountability picture there. In the parable, it's an analogous to what our lives will be. One day we're going to give a report of our lives. So the servant manager says to himself, "Oh my goodness, what am I going to do? I'm experiencing great loss here. My position will be gone. My income will be gone. I'm going to be seen as negative. Who's going to hire me when I've been fired for having mismanaged my master's possessions? I'm going to be at a great loss. And I'm not strong enough to go back to manual labor, and I'm too proud to beg." That's an interesting element that Jesus threw into the story. I can't manage manual labor, and I'm too proud to beg. What am I going to do? I'm totally at a loss. "I know what I'll do," he says, true to his character. "I will do something that will guarantee my future. I will make friends with those who are debtors in a way that they'll be obligated to me." So he gets out there, and he begins to call in those who are the debtors of his master. And he asks the first one, "How much do you owe my master?" The man replied, 100 jars of oil, olive oil. Now, 100 jars of olive oil, it's said, would be probably in the range of 900 to 1,000 gallons. It would be worth about 3 years' wages, and it would take about 150 olive trees to produce that much olive oil. And the manager said to him, "Get your bill, sit down quickly, and write 50. Notice something about the unsavory individuals of life. Do it quickly. Quick, 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 quick. Don't take time to think. Just do it. Write 50. Change the total, the net total on your account from 100 jars to 50. So there's about a year and a half of wages represented in that discounting. Then he asks another debtor, how much do you owe? And the man replied, 100 containers of wheat. How much is that? Well, the studies that I did show it worth, it was probably the size of about 1,000 bushels. Take about 100 acres in those days of manual labor to create 1,000 bushels of wheat. It probably represented in value about 8 to 10 years of manual labor wages. Manager told him, get your bill and write 80, so a 20% discount. When the master heard about this, the master praised the dishonest servant manager for being so clever. That reveals a little bit about the master too, doesn't it? He praised him for being so clever. Because worldly people are more clever than enlightened people in dealing with their own. That's an interesting phrase. The character of individuals is consistent throughout those who operate in life this way. And you know, I think Jesus was very mindful, having worked many years as a carpenter, he was very mindful of the way that business was conducted. And he knew there were probably many unsavory, unscrupulous, scrupulous people out there who just did not follow honest practices. So, the master praised him and said, yeah, you're a pretty clever guy. Kind of confirms my thoughts that you probably do cut corners. You cut corners. And then Jesus adds this comment in the story. I'm telling you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they will welcome you into eternal homes. Let me explain what I'm thankful to a number of people who have helped me understand this parable. I mean, the Bible has many references. I'm schooled in this by John MacArthur, Howard Dayton, Larry Burkett, Ron Blue, and Dave Ramsey. Many of these individuals who deal with financial management have taken this parable and said, what does this really mean? Let me give you what I've learned. Here Jesus is giving this parable, and he's saying, look at how the ungodly world is diligent about ensuring for themselves a future. How much more we who are followers of Christ should be good stewards of what the Lord has entrusted to us, that we may ensure for ourselves a good future. Do you get that? And that little phrase, when it all fails, when all of this wealth in this world's activities fail, you'll end up with your eternal outcome. Whoever is faithful with very little is also faithful with a lot. And whoever is dishonest with very little is also dishonest with a lot. There's a paradigm there that the Lord is teaching us about the reality. Some people have said to me over the years, well, if I made more money, I would give more money to God. I would prepare more for my eternal kingdom. Well, this verse tells us that it starts with the little. I remember being taught this by my father, and when I would, in my early teen years, be making money from cutting grass for people. I did that job for a while, and then I did watering tomatoes in greenhouses for a while, and all these little things, and I'd make a little bit of money, and I made it a point to take what portion I had set aside to be the Lord's, and I would give it. So if I made 20 bucks, I would give the Lord his portion. And I think that's the principle here, is that if we start with what we have, God will entrust to us more. Not that it's ours anyway, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So if you haven't been, and then he goes on to say, whoever's dishonest with very little is also dishonest with a lot. And that was obviously characteristic of this manager's heart. So if you haven't been faithful with unrighteous wealth, who will trust you with true wealth? God knows our lives. He sees every day the activities we're in, the money coming and going, the values, the motives of our heart. He sees it all. If you haven't been faithful with what belongs to others, to foreigners, to those who aren't you. Who will give you what is your own? Heavenly rewards. Heavenly rewards. It's an interesting thought here. Who does all this belong to anyway? We'll come back to that. No servant can serve two masters, because either he will hate the one and love the other, or be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and wealth. Jesus is saying there is an epic battle in humanity between God and money, wealth. There's an epic battle. You can't serve both. I didn't say that. Jesus said that. He must know he created us. He created money too. And so he's saying, I can't find a way that you're going to compromise. It's either one or the other has to take priority in your life. Now the Pharisees, listening in. Very interesting phrase there in Luke. Who loved money. Did you know that about the Pharisees? It says it. They loved money. Had been listening to all this and began to ridicule Jesus. Isn't that often the way it goes when we get convicted? We lash out with mocking or ridicule. So he told them, you try to justify yourselves in front of the people. This is Jesus speaking directly to the Pharisees. But God knows your hearts. Because what is highly valued by people is detestable to God. I share that story because it teaches us so many things. Let's go through the outline, see what we can draw from this for our own life and for practical application. The spiritual reasons why the Bible has so much to say about money. Because how we handle money seriously impacts our relationship with Jesus Christ. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon or the wealth of this world, who will commit to your trust the true riches? Eternal wealth. Money is a primary competitor with Christ for the lordship of our lives. That was obvious in that phrase where Jesus said, you can't serve both. It's either one or the other. You can't serve both. There's a competition going on in our lives every day between God and his values and teachings for our life and the earthly pursuit of wealth. Practical reasons. The Bible gives wise principles and plans for managing money. You know, the scriptures is intended for just teaching us everything we need to know about everything in life. I was watching some video quotes from Ronald Reagan, President Ronald Reagan. He had some tremendous wisdom. And one of the things that he shared at one of his speeches was he said, I've learned that every single challenge, problem, opportunity in life is addressed with principles in the Bible. Isn't that encouraging? Every single thing we face in life has already been addressed with principles from the Bible. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Why? That the man of God may be perfect or totally matured, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Scripture speaks volumes about principles of managing our wealth, managing time, managing the things that God entrusts to us. Secondly, the financial practices of most people are very different from the principles of the Bible. If we follow the inclinations of our heart, we're going to have very different thoughts and ways than what the Bible speaks about and God's thoughts and ways are. And Isaiah speaks to that very clearly. I'll just read it off the screen there. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. I appreciate the testimony of Larry Burkett when he said, someone challenged me to start a financial counseling ministry. So I got this little office and I got a telephone line, and this is a number of decades ago, and he said, I sat there waiting for people to come and seek counsel, and nobody came. The first year, basically I had all the time in the world. So I read through the Bible and I wrote out every single verse that had anything to do with money. 2,350 were found. That was my training school. Then I had something to share. And the Bible is what contains God's thoughts, God's ways, God's plans. And unless we get information from Him, our own thoughts are corrupted by our sin nature. And so much of the world around us is actively giving advice, especially during this time with all of these extra costs and shortage of income related to COVID-19. And everybody's scrambling. Right now, the government's bearing the burden of pouring all kinds of money into the population at large. But there's a payday coming for that. Then what? When the taps have to be shut off, what will the people do? And how will the government ever collect enough taxes to pay all of this back? It's an ugly scenario developing on the horizon. Man's ways are not God's ways. God's ways are different. And over the next few weeks, I hope we can learn some of God's ways that can instruct us as to how God wants us to manage the things in our life. What is God's part in our finances? What's God's part? Well, the first thing we got to accept is that God owns everything. God owns everything. He was the creator of it, and one day He'll wrap it up, burn it up, and start over with a new heaven and a new earth. He owns it all. We are entrusted with it for a period of time. I was listening to some comments made by people in the financial industry, and they said, do you realize that 95% of the land surface in British Columbia is owned by the government of British Columbia, which is you, the people? 95%. There's only 5% which is privately owned, titled property. And I thought to myself as I listened, well, actually, that's not quite right. 100% is owned by God. 100%. Let's look at some scriptures to help us with this. 1 Chronicles 29. Would you read it with me? I hope it's large enough that you can see it. If you can read it with me, that would get all of us together on it. All right? Wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation. And David said, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise thy glorious name. Did you see that phrase there? Everything in the heavens, everything on the earth is the Lord's. This is King David speaking in a prayer. He's recognizing God really, I don't own anything. It's all yours. I'm only here for a short period of time, and then I'm gone, and then passes on to somebody else for a short period of time, and then they're gone until the Lord Himself takes care of it all in the end. Got to keep that in mind. Psalm 24, verse 1. You want to read along? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. The whole earth is the Lord's. Does that give you a new perspective as you drive by some big fancy mansion down your street? And when you're tested with, I don't want to be envious, I don't want to covet. Actually, that guy doesn't own it either. He doesn't own it. It's the Lord's. It all belongs to Him. Doesn't that help with overcoming covetousness? I think it does. Psalm chapter 50, verse 10 through 12. For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. That's a lot of cattle. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. God says, do I need your money? I don't need your money. I don't need your cattle. I don't need your gold. I don't need your silver. I don't need your copper. I don't need any of it. It's all mine. I created it. So if I was hungry, would I come to you? No. We'll learn about what it is that God's heart is in even asking us to honor him with the possessions he gives us. Then over to Leviticus chapter 25. The land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine. You are strangers and sojourners with me. He's speaking about the children of Israel and coming into their tribal inheritance and how that they were to see it as a temporary lease. This is not yours. It's mine. I'm letting you live here for a while. Doesn't that sound different than the way the world thinks? Man, the world walk around and like, this could be yours. This just, and it's such cheap financing right now. This could be yours. Oh, it's not ours. It's the Lord's. And then over to Haggai 2, verse 8. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. Man runs around with all of their geological equipment trying to find out where the silver and the gold is, and God says, I know where it all is. I put it there. I know exactly where the really rich gold mines could be. I put it there. It belongs to me. I might let you have some for a while to use, but then it'll pass on to somebody else and somebody else and somebody else. God owns everything. The first step is to recognize God's ownership and discover contentment. Luke chapter 14, verse 33. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath cannot be my disciple. Now, I want to explain to you the word forsake. Are you with me? The word forsake, what does that mean? It's a very fascinating word in the Greek here. Apotasomeia is the Greek word. And it means our belongings being placed away from us in their proper category and not being permitted to become part of us. Forsaking says our belongings being placed away from us in their proper category and not being permitted to become part of us. Isn't that good? I mean, the Greek words just help us get this. And Jesus is saying there, unless you take that attitude that this really doesn't belong to me, it's not part of me, it's the Lord's, I'm just a steward over it for the current time, unless you get that picture, you cannot be my disciple. That's a pre-qualifier to being a disciple of Jesus. Getting the proper attitude and perspective about stuff. Very important. Then over in Philippians 4, verse 11, it's not that I speak in respect of want. This is Paul. For I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. And he did. We know he went through a lot. He learned to be content. And then over to 1 Timothy 6, 6 to 8. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Do you see a lot of contentment in our culture today? I don't. People are being pressed by marketing and advertising and salesmen and just more and more and bigger and better. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. Having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. If I have enough food and if I've got enough shelter for my physical needs, the Bible says, Paul writing to Timothy says, be content with that. Be content. Do you know how much stress there would be relieved if we could learn contentment? I was speaking with someone this week, and they were sharing about how they, when they had a mortgage, they had all these mortgage payments to make, and they were stressed. So they eventually got to a position where they didn't have a mortgage. And they realized, my goodness, I'm finding other things to get stressed about. It wasn't the mortgage at all. I just have this tendency to like stress. I find things to burden me. And he said, I've learned that it's about me managing my values and my focus and my emotions, not about the mortgage. Important to see how we need to cooperate with what God's word is to learn contentment. And the first perspective is to realize God owns everything, and that ultimately we just pass through. God is in ultimate control of every event. Number two, God's in ultimate control of every event. 1 Chronicles 29, 11, and 12, it spoke about how in there it says, "Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty for all that is in the heaven, all that in the earth. Yours is the kingdom. Both riches and honor come from you. You reign over all. In your hand is power and might." This is King David, who is king, recognizing this. He's saying, "Oh, God, you're in control." I was fresh reminded of this morning as I listened to an updated report on President Trump and his health. And I thought to myself, you know, this is a good reminder for all of us that we're not to look to a president or a king as our place of trust. We're to put our trust in the Lord. Kings will come and kings will go, but the Lord is forever. We're to put our trust in him and not become agitated or anxious with the passing of humanity as we go across the stage of life. God's in control. His plan will come to pass. Daniel chapter 4, 34 and 35. And at the end of the days, Nebuchadnezzar lifted. This is another king. In those days, king had absolute power. There was no judge and jury. It was the king. Lifted up his eyes into heaven, and mine understanding returned unto me, and I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that liveth forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation to generation to generation to generation. And all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. And he doeth it according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say unto him, "What doest thou?" During this time in elections here in BC and in the United States, please remember God's plan is not dependent upon politics. His plan will come to pass. Now, we have an obligation to be righteous people, citizens, and to fulfill his command to seek righteousness and pursue righteousness in our communities. But remember that the politics of humanity will not change God's plan. His plan is prepared. It will come to pass. He's in ultimate control of everything. God's desire is to have all events in our lives result in ultimate good. The story of Joseph there in Genesis 45 and Genesis 50. "You brothers, you sold me off. You wanted to get rid of me. And in the end, God took what was evil in your hearts and he turned it into good, because as a result of me being sold as a slave to Egypt, I ended up being the one who would turn around and rescue our family." When the 70 souls came out of Canaan and came to Egypt during the time of the famine, and then they had to bow before him as God had given him dreams that would happen, Joseph said, "This was of God. This was of God." And so often we don't see it till later. Sometimes we go through the deep valleys, we go through the struggles of life, we go through the ugly times, and we go, "What is happening?" God's ultimately in control. And if we follow his ways, and we must seek his ways from his word, his plans, his thoughts, how does he want to have us do it? If we do that, he says, "I'm interested in showing you that all things will come to pass for your good." He is a benevolent, loving, perfect Heavenly Father. I'm talking pretty fast here today. Any amens? I mean, this is so beautiful. What a wonderful rest we can take in these truths. And then God promises to provide our needs. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. "Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Many, many years ago, when I was an early teen, my father and I went down to Stanley Park to visit the hippie people, the Jesus people. Remember that movement? How many remember the Jesus People Movement? A few of you. The ones over in the Christian Education Building may not remember this because they probably weren't alive. But there was a time when a whole bunch of hippies found Jesus and said, well, basically, we can just sit around in a park because the Bible says we shouldn't worry about food and drink. So I went all, my father said, come with me. Good father, right? Lest you get deceived by these nuts, come with me and I want to have some little conversation with them. So we went down there, Lumberman's Arch, and he started chatting with some of them. So tell me what you believe and what do you see as the philosophy of life here? And so we got chatting and they, of course, went to this verse and said, we shouldn't take thought for what we eat, what we drink. And of course, he took them over to other scriptures that said, if you don't work, you shouldn't eat. That's God's righteousness. That's God's righteousness. God says, seek my righteousness, which means you should be producing something for others with your life. And if you don't, you don't deserve to eat. The verse there in Matthew 6:33 is a comparative verse. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That word first is the key word. Make it the priority in your life. What is first? Everything else is second. Everything else is second. God is very predictable in his faithfulness to provide. The surprise is that we can't always predict how he will do it. God says, I'll provide for you. If you follow my ways, I'll provide for you. But I'm not going to necessarily be so easy to follow. I'm going to surprise you at times. Look at the children of Israel going through the wilderness for 40 years. God's provision of manna for 2 million people every day, well, 6 days a week. Double on the sixth for the seventh. Would anybody have ever thought that was possible when they were considering the trip back in Egypt? God says, I'll provide for you. Watch me, trust me. And then God is not to be shrunk down to our human abilities and limitations. Believe what he says and the power he has to fulfill it. I'm just going to look at Luke 1:37. When the angel Gabriel came to visit Mary and said, I'm asking you to be the mother of the Savior. I'm asking you as a virgin to let your reputation be set aside. And she went, wow, like how is this going to work? I don't know how this could happen. Being human in her thinking. And Gabriel turns to her in that Luke chapter 1 passage and says, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. And then she had those beautiful words, be it unto me according to your word. Wow. What faith. I want to submit myself to your plan. Beautiful. And with that, God is limitless in what he can do. Don't ever underestimate him. What's our part in the finances? Our responsibility is that of a faithful steward or manager of what is the Lord's. 1 Corinthians 4:2. A steward, someone put in trust of something. Moreover, it is required of stewards that a man be found faithful. The number one qualification for God's stewardship program is faithfulness. And as he said, someone who is faithful in the little is faithful in the much. One of the things that I've always felt very strongly about as an elder and as a pastor, is that before we hire people, I want to see how much faithfulness they've demonstrated in volunteering. If their heart is there in volunteering faithfully, then I can entrust them with employment. That's the way it works. I think God does that with us. If you're willing to serve me, and then he calls us to give away money faithfully as a steward. Malachi 3:8 to 12, I'll let you read that. And 1 Corinthians speak about God saying, bring unto me funds. And again, we'll look at this in the future weeks, but God doesn't need the money. Giving away money is the way we break the back of loving it. You break the back of loving it by giving it away. Faithfully. On some percentage basis, because that way you get it consistent. All right. And God is asking us to be faithful in managing the small things, because as we manage the small things, we demonstrate our qualifications to manage the bigger things. You know how it works in your home. You start off with the little chores for your children. I want you to clear the table, or maybe it's even smaller than that. I just want you to bring the newspaper in. That's your first chore. And eventually, they develop skills to where we can let them run the whole house. We can let them basically take care of the house when we go away. It doesn't start like that when they're 5 and 6 years old, but they learn the skills. And as they are faithful in fulfilling the little things, they're entrusted more and more. If that's so true with us as parents, would that not be true with our Heavenly Father? I ask you the question, who's first in your life, God or wealth? And if someone was to come along and accuse you of saying, you've put God first in your life, and it went to court, what would be the proof that is true? What would be the proof? I share this third verse of a song, Be Thou My Vision. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart, high King of heaven, my treasure thou art. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for your instruction and in how we are to view life, view possessions, view time, view talents. And Lord, would you grant us the grace, even as it was sung about earlier, to put you first and keep you first in this world, that we would have laid up for us treasures in heaven that we'll enjoy for eternity. Forgive us for our short-sighted earthly thinking. Open our eyes to see the things of eternity. And if there's someone listening today who's not yet really made you Lord of their life, would you grant to them the grace and the courage to make that commitment today, to confess their need of a Savior as a sinner, and to come to you and ask you to be Lord and Savior of their lives, and then seek to follow your word with all the instructions you have, that we could have the joy of watching your power work in our lives. We give you thanks for what you'll do. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is a beautiful prayer after what we've heard. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them take my feet and let them be
Thank you.